So first speaker will be Dr. Shanta Karki from IRRI, and Dr. Karki has completed a PhD from Kyoto University and currently working on the C4 rice project. And now let's welcome Shanta for the presentation.
Hello, good afternoon, everyone. It's my pleasure to share with you some of our progress with the C4 gene transformation in rice. So I'll be talking about the importance of C4 photosynthesis. It will be just a brief recall because we already had different presentations this morning and also on Monday on the plenary sessions. Then I will also give you a brief differences between C3 and C4 photosynthesis. Then our current progress with the transformation of C4 genes into rice. We are also knocking down some endogenous rice genes, such as glycine decarboxylase. And then I'll summarize my talk in brief. So one of the major differences between C3 and C4 plants is the radiation use efficiency. In case of C4 plants, like you can see here in sorghum, the one shown in the red, the photosynthesis increases with the increase in light intensity. On the x-axis, you can see the change in the light intensity. As we increase the light intensity, the C4 photosynthetic pathway. Okay, I'll resume my talk. So you can see on the x-axis, we have the change in photosynthetic photon flux density, which is basically the light intensity. So in case of rice, the photosynthesis increases up to certain extent, but after it reaches certain point like 1500 micromole, the photosynthesis saturates. That means even if you increase the flux density, the rate of CO2 assimilation remains constant. However, in C4 like sorghum, the rate of photosynthesis keeps on increasing and the difference becomes much higher with the increase in light intensity. And to this audience, I don't need to explain the importance of the more amount of rice needed in future. And also it is important to keep the supply of rice high enough so that the prices don't go very high and can be affordable to all the consumers around the world. And one of the important things that can be done to increase the productivity drastically is to introduce the better photosynthetic pathway, which is also known as C4, that will better utilize the sunlight. The basic difference between C3 and C4 photobiochemistry is, in C3 photosynthesis, the CO2 is fixed by rubisco and also assimilated, and it first becomes into 3-carbon compound. Whereas in case of C4 photosynthesis, the photosynthesis occurs in 2 different places. The carbon dioxide is initially fixed by phosphoenol pyruvate into 4-carbon compounds, which is broken down in bundles of cells to release carbon dioxide in the rubisco to provide Calvin cycle. In this way, the C4 photosynthesis improves the photosynthesis by suppressing the oxygenase activity of rubisco. When we see in nature, as told by our earlier speakers as well, C4 is an evolutionary pathway that was evolution from the C3 ancestors. And this is a phylogenetic tree of the C4 grasses family, and I have taken it from Brutnell et al. 2010. So here you can see the C4 has evolved at different times and in different families. However, in case of rice family, the C4 photosynthesis has not evolved, and that's why it's not possible for us to do traditional crossing or hybridization to make a C4 rice. That's why we are adopting a strategy of genetic engineering. So the biochemical pathway that we want to introduce into rice is two-cell type. And these are the enzymes or genes that we need to overexpress in rice. The ones in green we have already transformed and overexpressed. The ones in pink are the genes currently cloned and are under, they will be transformed soon. And because we want to make it the Calvin cycle to occur in bundle C cell, we have to knock down the existing Calvin cycle in the mesophyll cells and also the photorespiratory pathway that takes place in mesophyll cells. So these will be the genes that we need to knock down in mesophyll cells of rice. So this is a brief update on our transformation pipeline. We are using immature embryos of IS64. We are using agrobacterium mediated transformation, and all the plants we regenerate undergo molecular evaluation at DNA, RNA, and protein levels. If you see here, we are taking the strategy of co-transformation, and these are the genes, the full-length genes from maize that have been cloned and introduced into rice. The co-transformation efficiency is from 15 to 20, which is very good for the indica variety. And these are the number of PCR positive plants. In fact, we get more than 100 plantlets per construct. And this is the latest generation for some of the genes, like Pepsi we have in T3 generation, MDS T3, and so on. So I'll be talking about them in specific. For example, this is a progress for maize Pepsi gene, and these are progenies from T3 event. And you can see all the progenies have PCR product specific for maize Pepsi, and this is P is for plasmid, which we use as positive control. RC is the rice control, which is regenerated from untransformed callus. And on the right, you can see it's a protein plot analysis, and we use the antibody specific to maize Pepsi. And this is MC, is the maize control. You can see there is good accumulation of maize protein. The next is rice control, the non-transgenic regenerated plant, which does not have any maize Pepsi protein. And 1 to 8 are the progenies of a single event. We saw good accumulation of Pepsi protein, almost similar to that level of maize. And this event was selected from T0, which had almost equal level of maize, and the progenies are showing equal amount. So I can say that maize Pepsi has been stably integrated and expressed in our transgenic rice plants. We also check the physiology by doing some photosynthetic measurements. On the left is the carbon dioxide response curve. Both the transgenic, that is in red, and the rice control show similar level of photosynthesis. With increased carbon dioxide, you can see the photosynthesis is increasing. But we did not see major improvement in the transgenic. And it's quite accepted as we don't expect a vast level of change with a single gene. And previous authors also have reported similar results for maize Pepsi. On the right is the light response curve, and both transgenic and control show the similar kind of response. And these are some of the phenotypes of our plants, and these are the controls. And you can see the phenotype is similar to that of control, and they produce good amount of seeds. Next is for the malic dehydrogenase, and for this also we have the T3 plants. They had stable integration of the gene, and it was accumulating in protein level and almost more than in the maize control. For the light response and CO2 response curve, this particular transgenic event showed slight improvement or enhancement in the CO2 assimilation rate, both with the change in carbon dioxide level and the light intensity level. And the plants are very normal and they look like the control. So this means that we have been able to select the plants with optimum level of protein accumulation. Next is the malic enzyme, and for this we have plants in T2 generation, and you can see the progenies are accumulating protein, and the plants are growing well, and we'll be characterizing them at physiological level as we advance them to next generation. For the PPDK, these are T1 plants, that's why I am showing you also the southern blot hybridization. The first one is PCR. We were able to get the PCR band for specific to match PPDK gene, and the protein of 92 kilodalton was expressed in all the progenies of this event. And we did copy number analysis, and you can see it's a single integration, and the plants are growing normally. So I'm showing you all this because we select our plants based on copy number and protein expression. Only the events that have one or two or less than three copies are advanced to next generation. And for the protein, we are not selecting too high or too low accumulation. We are usually selecting the line switch, so 80% to 100% or similar to that maize protein level in the rice, so that we don't expect any impairment physiologically in case of the transgenic plants. Then, as I said, we have good lines for PPDK, Pepsi, so we crossed them and we had a F1. This F1 was PCR screened and analyzed by protein level. All the F1s that have good protein accumulation, we crossed with the malic dehydrogenase plants. And now we have a F1 plants where we did PCR screen with all three genes of interest. And you can see some of the proteins like number 5, number 7, number 21, gave the amplicon of appropriate size for MAGE, Pepsi, PPDK, and MDH. And then we did the Western blot, and these three progenies, we had all the genes, also good accumulation of MDH, Pepsi, and PPDK proteins, as you can see here. And this one is a progeny from another cross, which also has given the protein accumulation for all three genes. So we have few more such F1 plants. So both PCR and Western blot confirm that our F1s have all the three genes. And they are growing well, and this was taken when they were flowering, but now we have already harvested the F2 seeds, and the plants are in early vegetative stage. And we have germinated them together with MAGE PFC transgenic plants so that we can cross this F2 with three genes and malic enzyme in order to stack four MAGE genes in one plant. Then another gene that we have done is the MAGE dicarboxylase transporter 1. This is also a full-length gene that was cloned from MAGE. And this is very important transporter as it transports oxaloacetate to mesophyll chloroplast and also diffuses malate to Bonacci cells where it is broken down to release carbon dioxide to Rubisco. For this, we have T0 plants. And you can see here, there are some plants which have the construct integrated, and there are more plants, and we do have them growing. Then we did northern blot analysis to see the transcription level, and this one is the maize, where it has good transcript level. The rice control did not show any transcript level for maize D1, and these are the T0 events. You can see there is different level of accumulation, and some events like 24, 47, 106, they have the transcript level equivalent or even more than MAGE. When you look at the phenotype, some of the plants flower quite earlier than the control. Like you can see, control is just flowering, but here the plants have the seeds maturing, but somewhere like this. And because these are T1, so we do T0 plants, so we do expect some level of variations. So we have already harvested T1 seeds, and soon we'll be advancing them to next generation based on our transcript accumulation and copy number. As I said before, in order to make safer rice, we need to knock down some of the genes in rice, and one of them is the glycine decarboxylase. And glycine decarboxylase comes in the photorespiratory cycle, and photorespiration occurs when Rubisco takes oxygen and it oxidizes the RuBP to form 2-phosphoglycolate. If it takes carbon dioxide, the Kelvin cycle occurs or the carboxylation occurs. But if it takes oxygen, there is a different product, and it, because it consumes RuBP, which is only produced by photosynthesis, so it's a wasteful metabolism. And the glycine decarboxylase come here where it breaks down the glycolate and other products to give release carbon dioxide. And it's quite important because in C3, C4 intermediates and C4 species, GDC is accumulated, especially in Bondose cells, but in rice, it's in mesophyll. That's why we need to knock down. Our strategy is we design artificial microRNA targeting the S subunit of glycine decarboxylase, and it's driven by MAGE Pepsi promoter because MAGE Pepsi is shown to be more preferable to mesophyll cells, and we have the plants. We saw the knockdown in transcript level. The first one is rice control, and you can see we have progenies in which we have reduced level of transcript. And the phenotype, they were quite smaller than the controls, and they were late flowering, and we have more of those plants that we are doing further characterization. So in summary, we have already transformed 8 maize genes involving C4 biochemical pathway, and we have been able to express them. Then transgenic plants with Pepsi, PPDK, and MDH has been crossed, and now in F2 generation, we were able to knock down the glycine decarboxylase S subunit in rice, and we will be doing further analysis for cell-specific expression, such as the immunolocalization, so that we know where our genes are expressing, if they are behaving like in a C4 plant. And we'll also be doing some more physiological analysis to see the gene function. This work was done by a number of people involved, so I want to thank all of them, and I also like to thank IRRI, Gates Foundation, and UKAIR for funding the project. Thank you.
Okay, so questions for Shanta? Okay, must be really clear. So thanks, Shanta, again.
Thank you.
So now let's...